Hey everybody, it's Alex with Engineering Applied. In this video, I'll be giving you an overview of the constraint set function found within an Autodesk Inventor assembly file. If you want more easy to understand and practical content like this, made by an experienced engineer like myself, make sure you like this video, subscribe to the channel, and turn on notifications so you don't miss out on any helpful content like this in the future. If you're looking for a specific function, check the description for timestamps. And if you don't find what you're looking for in this video, make sure you check out the other videos in my Autodesk Inventor series playlist, because I know you'll find exactly what you need there. Let's get started. Okay, everybody. So here we are in our assembly file, and I went ahead and pulled up two different types of connectors. So the one on the right is a panel mount connector, and the one on the left is the corresponding receptacle that mates with this connector on the right. And so what we're going to do here is we're going to use the constraint set function alongside with a user coordinate system to create an effective and efficient mate without having to line up a bunch of different entities within these parts to one another. So normally what we would do is we go up to constrain under the assemble tab in the relationship section, and we would apply normal mate. So we could maybe mate this face here to this inner edge here and so on and so forth. But instead of doing that, what we can do is we can apply a user coordinate system, which will allow these parts to line up the same way every single time in a single step, rather than having to make several different mates to fully define the constraints between these two models. So let's go ahead and jump out of this command window. And what we'll do is we'll open up each one of these two models individually and apply those user coordinate systems individually as we move along. And then we'll come back into this assembly and apply this final constraint. All right, I've opened up the receptacle file. And what we're going to do is we're going to apply this user coordinate system along this back wall here, because this is where it mates up with this inner edge on this panel mount connector, okay? So we're going to essentially center this coordinate system up with the center point of a line going down this face and a center point going across this way. So what we're going to do first is we're going to create a sketch on this back face here, and we're going to just right click and go to new sketch onto that face. And I'm going to project some geometry. So I want to use this line, and that line should do. And I'll just go into my marking menu and hit okay. And then now let's go ahead and draw some extra lines here so we can drop a center point. So we'll let that snap to the midpoint. Let's look at the front of this face again. Okay, I'm going to bring it down to this face, make sure it's perpendicular, left click. And then we're gonna do the same on this side. So we're gonna pick up that center point, that midpoint, and then we're gonna bring it all the way over and drop it there. Now we're just gonna drop a point right in the middle there. And the reason why I'm doing this is because I'm creating a central reference point for this coordinate axis or this coordinate system to attach itself to. So now that we've done that, I'm gonna finish the sketch here. And I'm gonna go up to work features, and I'm gonna select UCS, okay? And then I'm just gonna hover over that center point that I dropped, and you'll see it snaps to that. And I'm gonna left click. And it says to specify the X axis direction. I'm actually not gonna click on anything else. At this point in time, you can click other entities to reorient this coordinate system. But what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna right click and then go to finish, okay? And you'll see it drops it into place. And one thing I want you to note is the direction of the Z axis. It's facing outwards, or I guess to the right or inwards towards this mating connection. And so what we're going to do is we're going to essentially do the same thing, but in reverse on the panel mount connector. So now that we have this in place, let's jump over to our panel mount connector. And remember, since that front face of this receptacle here, this face here, is mating with this edge, what I want to do is go ahead and create this next sketch on this face. Okay, so I'm going to right click and go to new sketch. And I'm going to do the same exact thing that I did with the other one. So I'm going to go ahead and project some geometry. Okay, we'll go up to line. And let's find that midpoint. Snap it into place. We'll do the same thing on this side. Okay, let that snap into place. And let's drop a point on that intersection point. All right, so now we go to okay and finish sketch. Let's do the same thing. So we'll go to up to work features and drop a UCS on that point, let it snap. Now notice the Z axis is facing the opposite direction. So what happens when we use this constraint set function is it aligns both coordinate systems with one another, which moves the parts around accordingly to match those coordinate systems. So In this particular case, we actually want the z-axis to be going in the opposite direction so that when these two parts align their coordinate systems, the mating connection will be in its proper orientation. So let's go ahead and do that. So what I can do is I can finish this command and then go back into the model browser here on the left side, and I can right click on UCS1, which is this coordinate system I just made. And I can go to redefine feature. And when I do that, I can hover over this y-axis, and you'll see I get this little symbol that pops up. It's like a rotational symbol around an axis. I can left click, and I can actually rotate this coordinate system about that y-axis, which is exactly what I want to do. And I want to rotate this by 180 degrees. So I'm going to type in 180, and I'm going to hit enter. And when I do that, you'll see the z-axis is going towards the back. And when these two parts align with one another, our mate should be created in the correct orientation. So let's go ahead and just right click to finish that. Okay, so now that we've finished that, let's go into our assembly. So you'll see I have my coordinate systems populated in my assembly. And what I can do now is I can go up to the relationship section, click on constrain, go to the constraint set tab. And before we continue on, I want to go ahead and cover the major sections found here in this place constraint window under the constraint set tab. And once I go ahead and cover those, I'll execute the command so we could see its behavior. And then we'll discuss briefly how we can further augment the location of these user coordinate systems. Our first section is the type section, and conventionally this is where we have multiple types of constraints housed. However, under constraint set, we only have the one type, which is UCS to UCS, our user coordinate system to user coordinate system. Okay, so moving to the right, we have our selections section, and this is where we can toggle our selection filters to pick up the various entities we want to mate together. So by default, the first one is pre-highlighted, and I know it's highlighted because it's got a blue fill inside of its little tile. And I can switch back and forth between these at will. And you'll see when I click on the number two, I get the blue fill inside of the box. That means the second selection filter is currently active. Okay, moving on to the right, we have our pick part first option. So let's go back to the first selection filter. Conventionally, what will happen is when I hover over the coordinate system, it'll just go straight to that coordinate system. Okay, and I'll highlight that in green. And the same thing with this one over here. But when I check this box for pick part first, what happens is I have to select the part body first or the component first, okay? So let's say, for example, that these two parts were housed in an assembly where I can't quite get to this coordinate system in the back because it's hidden behind something. Well, what I can do is I can pick an exposed part of that component, okay? So I'll just select that connector itself. And then now when I click a second time, it won't highlight anything that's associated with anything other than this component that I originally selected. So even though I'm hovering over this coordinate system, it's not selecting it for me because it's not associated with this component I pre-selected on the first mouse click. So now let's go ahead and hover over this coordinate system, and we can left click to select that. And then you'll see it snaps to the selection filter number two automatically. And we do the same thing. So we're going to select this part body first. Okay. And then now we're able to select that coordinate system. So even if I flip this around and hover over this one, it's not allowing me to select that because it's not associated with this part body. So let's go ahead and select this second user coordinate system. And when I do that, you'll see that I get a part preview. So moving down, we have this little pair of glasses here that says show preview. So we can either toggle our preview settings on or off using this checkbox here on the left. So as you saw there, we see a preview of the mate before we actually hit okay. But let's go ahead and hit cancel and try that again without the preview option enabled. So we'll go ahead and select those two entities once again. Okay, and you see how this connector stays frozen in space. It doesn't preview that mate for us, but when I hit okay, it still accomplishes that mate. Moving down in our command window, we have our name section where we can apply a custom name to this constraint. And to access this extended menu, all you have to do is click these two arrows on the bottom right-hand corner of the original window, and it'll extend the menu. And let's go ahead and type in a custom name. So we'll just type in UCS constraint. Okay, and then let's pick up our two entities that we want to constrain. And we'll hit OK. And now when we go to our relationships folder up underneath our constraint set assembly, we can see that we have our custom named constraint there. And we can always right click on that. We can delete it, edit it, and so on and so forth. Now let's go ahead and inspect the mate that we just created. So as I rotate this part around, you'll see that this receptacle here on the left is mated up perfectly with the panel mount connector. Okay, and we did that in a single step after we created our UCS within each part file. This can be such a powerful tool, especially when you have an assembly that contains multiple parts that need to be aligned with one another, but you don't want to have to go through and manually create all of those constraints. So let's say, for example, we have another one of these panel mount connectors. Okay, so let's go ahead and pull another one in. We'll drop it anywhere. And let's go ahead and ground it so it doesn't move because it's going to be fixed in a panel. And then let's pull in another one of these receptacles here. So we'll open this file up, drop it anywhere, it doesn't matter. And so instead of mating everything up manually like we would have to do normally, let's go ahead and finish this constraint in one step. So we'll go to Constraint, Constraint Set. Let's select this UCS and this UCS. And you can see it snaps it all into place in one step. We'll hit OK. And again, when I click and drag on this receptacle, it's not moving anywhere. It's frozen all degrees of freedom in a single step. Now, before I go ahead and finish this video up, I want to talk about how we can further edit the location of these coordinate systems that we've placed in either one of these parts. So we'll go ahead and edit the location of the UCS within the receptacle file. So what I want to do first is I want to go over to the model browser. And I want to go to UCS1. And if you're unsure which UCS it is, you could just left click on it once. It'll highlight it in blue. And then we can right click on that, go to redefine feature. And we have a few different ways that we can actually redefine this feature. Our first way to redefine this feature is we can hover over this little point in the middle, and you see we get this four-way arrow that pops up, okay? We can left click and we can just move the mouse around and move this entity, or we can type in a delta X, a delta Y, or a delta Z value. So let's say, for example, we wanna move it a quarter of an inch in the X direction. I can type in 0.25 and then I can press tab to move over to the next entry for the delta Y. Let's say we don't wanna move it in the Y direction, so we'll type a zero. And then let's hit tab once more, and then we'll move it, let's say an eighth of an inch in the Z direction. Actually, let's move it back by an eighth of an inch. So we'll type in a negative sign and then 0.125. Okay. And when I do that, I can just hit enter. And now it moves that coordinate system accordingly after selecting this little point here on the origin. Another way we can redefine this UCS entity is we can right click on it, go to redefine feature, and we can actually rotate about an axis by hovering over the stem on each one of these axis arrows in this triad. And you see we get a little symbol. It's a line with an arrow revolving around it. Okay, so once we find an axis that we want to revolve around, so let's say the X axis, for example, we can left click and then we can type in an angle value. So let's say we want to rotate this by 90 degrees. I can type in 90. And you'll see it flips around by 90 degrees. And then of course you can use a negative sign in that field if you want to, and it'll flip it the other direction, or you can enter any value up to 360 degrees. So once you have your angle value set, you can hit enter and it'll redefine that feature for you. Now we can also translate this UCS along an axis direction by going to redefine feature in your model browser. And then all we have to do is hover over the end on each one of these axis arrows. And you'll see we get a double headed arrow that pops up. This is to translate along that triad segment. So we can left click on the end of this arrow here in the Z direction. And let's say we want to translate this along the Z direction by half an inch. So all we have to do is type in 0.5 and you'll see it moves forward by 0.5. Or let's say, for example, we want to move it back by 0.5 inches. All I have to do is put a negative sign here and it'll move in the opposite direction of that Z axis arrow. Okay, so once we have that set, we can just hit enter and it'll reposition that triad for us. Now I'm going to go ahead and actually translate this forward so that it's flush with the end of this part of the receptacle so that when we go back into our assembly, we can update that model to show that the connector is just interfacing with the panel mount connector, but not actually plugged in yet. So what we'll do is we'll go back to redefine feature. We're gonna click on the end of this Z axis and I'm gonna type in 0.256 inches, okay? And I'm gonna press enter. Right click to go to the marking menu and go to finish. And then now let's go back to our assembly and we'll go to local update here at the top. And you see it updates the interface between these two components because that UCS location has changed. This is really powerful for when you want to make a bunch of changes in your assembly that are related to two coordinate systems that you've already mated together, but you can make all of these changes in one step by just editing the UCS location in your individual component files. That's all for this segment of the Autodesk Inventor Assembly Creation module, where I gave you an overview of the constraint set function. I really hope that you found this tutorial to be helpful and that you put what you've learned into practice so you can continue developing your skills as you work your way through these lessons. Also, before you watch the next video in the series, make sure you subscribe to my channel and turn on notifications to stay up to date on future content that will help you create the future you want for yourself. And of course, don't hesitate to leave a comment or reach out via my website contact page and let me know if there's anything else you'd like to learn about or see on this channel. I really appreciate you choosing to stop by and learn with me, and I'll see you again soon.